The story goes back surprisingly far, and we start with James Walker, who was born in 1878.
This doesn't sound like a very Latin name.
No, James Walker. So they're Americans. Okay. But we'll get to why it's called Alpato.
Oh, you think Latin people can't be Americans?
Wow. Not in 1878.
Bet you wish your microphone was backwards. Because certainly your ideas are.
There wasn't much I found on his childhood or where he was born, but in 1890, at the age of 12, James' father dies, and it's on him to go get a job and help support the family. At the age of 26, James and his new wife are in Los Angeles, or they were here the whole time, I don't know. But they purchase a building at what everyone calls the heart of downtown, but it's actually what I call the outskirts of downtown, on Mission Road on the other side of the river across from Union Station off of Alvarado.
So what is that, like East LA?
Bordering East LA, or maybe Boyle Heights. It's like on the other, directly on the other side of the river. Like they're behind El Pato is the river. I guess it's
well, that's where the ducks live.
Well, I mean, if you're gonna find a duck, it's probably in the river. The building is for his new company, Walker Manufacturing, and he's going to specialize in Mexican foods, which is cool that someone saw a market for a region that had a large Mexican population, because less than 6 years before this, we were Mexico. Walker Foods does not officially establish itself until 1914. So they are selling American salsa. It's the first company to do that in 1914.
Huh. By your own admission, they did not start with salsa. It was like an enchilada sauce.
Right.
Which is not salsa.
It's a
hot sauce. Some might consider enchiladas to be spicy.
Al Pato is mostly known for their tomato base, the tomato sauce.
Yeah.
And then they had some other stuff too. And they later came out with the salsa. But at first they were selling this kind of cooking base that we'll get into.
Yeah. Yeah. They were selling something that wasn't a salsa.
When you gave me the assignment, you're like Al Pato. And I'm like, well, all right. And they're important because Al Pato was one of, if not the first, to produce salsa in the U.S. American salsa.
Salsa is a loose term
for it. It is a very loose term for what they do. I agree. And they were the first American salsa to travel over the border and be sold to Mexico, where it became popular as a cooking base. While Tapatio and Cholula are put on the top of food like this,
right.
Al Pato tomato sauce. Wait.
Show me how to use Tapatio.
It's similar to like the way you would shake in America, like a salt. Imagine like a salt and pepper.
In America, how you say ketchup.
Ketchup. How you say salt and pepper.
So they were selling it back to Mexico. This American.
The tomato base that they were making here in America, they were selling to Mexico.
And that's then like weird.
Yeah. What do you mean? What do you? It's the 20s.
Everything was backwards.
Yeah, everything was backwards.
We just came out of World War I. We didn't know Mexico from America.
It's just one stretch of land. It's just one lyric in a John Lennon song.
It's just one area waiting to be turned into trenches.
So, Tapatio and Cholula are put on top of food to spice it up. Al Pato tomato sauce was mixed in as a base.
Right.
So you can make it with chilies. Enchiladas. And enchiladas.
Only enchiladas.
You can mix it with chilies and onions and garlic. You can mix it with rice. Al Pato was also the first and largest users of the cascabel chilies, and the biggest users of that in the world, which are cultivated in different states in Mexico. They look like cherries and they taste like red.
Doesn't cascabel mean rattlesnake?
I think so, yeah.
Do they taste like rattlesnakes?
No, but they'll bite you.
Yeah, well, there's another snake that I've been thinking about a lot lately. It's not a rattlesnake, but it's a little scarier than a rattlesnake. It's a cobra.
And here I thought you were going for an Escape in LA reference.
That was last month. This month is all Cobra Kai all the time.
I told you when you first started watching it, don't tell me to watch it. Everyone's telling me to watch it. I get that it's good. I'll get around to it. Do not come to me like, it's so good you gotta watch it.
Well, this is 3 years in, so it's stupid for me to be like, have you heard of this show, Cobra Kai?
I'm telling you that you're probably going to have to watch the sequels to Karate Kid before you continue, but you don't care.
Nah.
According to gourmetsleuth.com, cascabels are moderately hot.
The unimpeachable.
Cascabels are moderately hot and have a nutty flavor with a rich tannic and slightly smoky nuance. On the heat scale, the cascabel is considered a moderately hot chili of about like 4 on a scale to 1 to 10. It allows it to be used as mostly like flavoring without adding a lot of heat to the dish. So it's not really like a salsa, if you're like hot sauce salsa.
That's something that, because it falls into a weird category that's quote unquote enchilada sauce taco sauce, whatever that is.
Right.
Yeah, it's not hot sauce because it certainly isn't hot.
Yes.
But it kind of is hot sauce.
It has like
it's red.
I call it, it tastes like red. It's got a kick to it for sure. Like for me, who doesn't like spicy food, which I feel like the listeners are revolting right now, but I don't like spicy food really.
Of podcasts about spicy food.
I don't hate doing this. How dare you?
You insisted I give you a glass of milk before we recorded.
I wouldn't call it spicy, but it has a kick to it. It gives me heartburn. I don't know. That burns.
That's just a tomato. A tomato is hot sauce to you.
Ketchup gives me heartburn too. James Walker's business really gets going in the 20s, and it's reported that he would hand deliver the sauce cans to households and to mom and pop shops. James passes away in 1947, and that's when his son, James Jr., takes over. James Jr.'s brother, the other son, Robert, at the time, joins the company, Walker Foods, and branches off into the vinegar business and starts making mustard under the name Golden State or Walker Products, which I, like I said...
How come they're not around?
They we'll get to it. Which I, you know, they package...
I want to know now.
They package chilies, mustards, and vinegars. According to the Al Pato website, Walker Products was the first company to make white distilled vinegar, like in the country, I guess.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. One of the first...
Of course it was white.
One of the first customers for mustard was in 1948, a new hamburger drive-thru in Baldwin Park called In-N-Out was using their mustard, and their supplier was Walker Products. Schneider's Shop Local. Robert was
They still use their mustard?
From what I can tell, yeah.
God, the In-N-Out is so loyal to everything.
Yeah, they really are. Yeah, it's hard to be mad at. Like, I know that they're probably crazy conservative and super rich in funding a bunch of crazy stuff, but they're so loyal.
They're so loyal to the Proud Boys.
But the thing with In-N-Out was, like, they give money equally to both sides, but also, like, well, you give them money. Proud Boys farm. We love In-N-Out so much. I've given them so much money.
And you've given the Proud Boys so much money. Too.
I'm tired of handing them cash all the time.
I'm tired of them mugging me. So.
Robert was also able to purchase factory space near that location as well to keep the Walker food branches together. So the company continues growing through the decades. James Walker Jr. has a heart attack on the Al Pato plant floor and dies.
Oh my God.
I know, it's awful. The reins in the company were passed on to Robert Walker, the dad, but soon the entirety of the Walker Foods company was given to Robert's son, Robert Walker Jr., who had started working for the company when he was 12 years old, the same age that his grandfather had started working after the loss of his father. I'm not sure, but it seems like Robert Walker Sr. passed around the same time as his brother. So now it's all this grandson who's taking over everything. And he's the current CEO. Robert Walker Jr. did not see himself in the position and was quite accomplished and was quite older. He was 56 when he took the company over, but he took it over and around this time merged both the family companies together. So now it's one big company.
Walker. Al Pato.
Yeah.
Walker Foods, Al Pato Ranger.
I gotta watch that show.
Yeah, you'll watch that, but you won't watch Cobra Kai. You want to see some real karate?
Nobody wears denim and makes me mad.
Some people wear denim.
So Walker Foods, Al Pato, they're really a family business, and not just management, but the people who work for the plant are family people. They've been working for the plant for like 60 plus years. And as Robert Walker Jr. puts it, they've devoted their lives to this company. You work your whole life at this factory working for this company. So like it's like a big family organization. He was hesitant to take over, but he did not want to see the workers' jobs jeopardized. And he realized that it was his time to step up to the plate, which I think is admirable. Robert now owns Walker Foods with his three cousins, Frank, Russell, and Susan. Around the time they added delicious jalapeno, the green can, enchilada sauce, the red can to the product line. They've added their own bottled hot sauces to the game, flavors like a regular one, jalapeno and chipotle, which is a new one. And they introduced red hot tomato with jalapeno as a sauce. And then they got themselves the Great White Whale. They added McDonald's to their client list, which is, a huge get. It's like a billion.
What is McDonald's? They're using their mustard or their...
I was wondering if they...
Enchilada sauce on my Big Mac?
I was thinking now that I have spicy chicken, I wonder if they use any of that ingredients, but they probably use vinegar for something. They use mustard for sure. They don't have anything with jalapenos in the menu.
They make McFlurries too, right?
They also make cream for McFlurries. Yeah. They make whatever issue breaks McFlurry machines. That's what they make. They make that.
Every single time I try to redeem a free McFlurry voucher and the machine's broken, that's Al Pato.
You know who to thank now. There was trouble in 2013 when they had to pull Al Pato's salsa picante off the shelves after the FDA found a troubling amount of lead in the sauce.
Oh boy.
According to the article, and I don't know if this is true, but it sounds like all hot sauces have a little bit of lead in it, but some of them get flagged for having that excess of lead. I don't know if that's true, but it sounded like what the article was making it sound like. Walker fought these findings and said it was not as high as a report was claiming, but he also said that someone would have to eat a lot of it.
Put that lead in there.
Just a bullet floating in there.
And he's like going insane like the late era Roman emperors because he's had so much lead in his system, and he made his vice president a horse.
You got to trust me on this. You just have to trust me. He knows what direction to go in.
The CEO is now an actual duck. There's no lead in our sauce, quack.
Yeah, listen to that duck. That looks pretty on it.
He's got the idea, quack.
See how he's pooping everywhere? He's on it.
See, there's no lead in that. There is duck poop.
Taste it. Taste the lead. See? No lead. He also was saying you'd have to eat a lot of it in a short amount of time for it to
Which leads us to our El Pato challenge. Yeah,
enter the American Southwest. I'll eat all of it. But the article had this statement. If a child were to consume the sauce twice a day for a year, they would be exposed to 1.1 to 1.8 micrograms per deciliter of lead, according to the study. That's significantly less than the CDC's established limit limit of 10 micrograms per deciliter. So like it was high for what is usually you get, but you'd have to eat so much of it in a short amount of time for it to affect you. So they weren't that frazzled by this report.
I could get affected by this.
If someone's going to get sick from it, it would be you. According to this article, the hot sauce is also made in Mexico and bottled and shipped here, but I couldn't find anything on the website or any other mention of that. So that's kind of weird that this, I don't know how accurate this like
the gourmet report. Sleuth.
Yeah. They had another blow during the recession, of course, and the 2020 COVID outbreak, another big hit, like back to back, this company took big hits. The pandemic hit them hard like it did everybody. The company put anyone over this age of 60 on paid home leave, which is nice. They brought in increased protection measures like plastic barriers between workstations, and they instituted contact tracing protocols for anyone who steps onto the property. But the company is still going strong. There were no layoffs and operations were, you know, they kept going safely throughout the pandemic. Al Pato and Walker Foods are now over 100 years old, starting here along the river. For as a cult status as it is, its popularity is only existent here in the Southwest. The company does not have a far reach, but the labels adorn Flickr and Pinterest and Instagram. And
they're really nice labels.
Yeah, they're great labels.
Mallards.
Yes.
Oh, I love a good mallard.
Oh, that's a regular dirt duck? No, thank you. I want a mallard. You know, you'll get your Instagram people and Pinterest people using the cans to like plant succulents or flowers or whatever. They use the cans for different things. They'll put erasers in
it. You know there's lead in those cans. That's not good for your succulent.
It's breathing now. The label's reach is greater than the sauce, which is well-loved in Los Angeles. It's not really a hot sauce, so people don't make a big deal about it, but it's like a staple in a lot of Latino households. So it gets lumped in with like Mexican.
Yeah, that's
food.
What I'm talking about. Yeah. Like it's not salsa, but it's, if you're going to look for El Pato in a grocery store, it's going to be in the salsa section.
It will.
Yes. So that confuses me. That's weird that it was a white guy named Johnny Walker or whatever you said. Walker. Oh, Johnny Lawrence? That started it, and then it like marketed it back to
like he wanted to make American salsa. I mean, like he was living in 1868 Los Angeles or whatever, so like I'm sure like there's a lot of salsa around here. I bet I could make my own salsa too. But like there was a lot of articles that like, yeah, we don't really know too much about James Walker and like the day-to-day. Like there are other companies that are just
same with the La Victoria. Like I know that they were called the La Baca family. Yeah, and that's all I know about them. They came from Mexico, and that's all I know about them.
These salsa people are keeping it pretty tight. They're pretty tight-lipped about everything.